America is essentially a dream.
Good evening. Welcome to Network X. I'm your host, Bill Brignoli. Throughout its history, the United States has intervened in the foreign affairs of scores of nations. At times, we're told this was necessary to protect U.S. strategic interests. At other times, we're told that it was to promote the causes of freedom and democracy. What is rarely ever revealed, though, is the twisted meaning of those terms, strategic interests, freedom, and democracy, as they're defined by U.S. policymakers. Nor are we ever told the true cost in both blood and sovereignty that is paid by the citizens of those countries who are the victims of those interventions. Tonight, Network X is proud to have with us someone whose life has been dedicated to telling that missing part of U.S. history on behalf of those who have suffered as a result of it and on behalf of those of you who may have a different vision for the role that the U.S. might play in a truly free and democratic world. Please join me in welcoming to the TCI studios, Michael Parenti. Mr. Parenti is a world-renowned political analyst and author and lecturer. He holds a PhD in political science from Yale University and has taught at numerous colleges in both the United States and abroad. Mr. Parenti has written several books, only some of which are Inventing Reality, which is a scathing critique of the role that the corporate mass media plays in this democratic society, The Sword and the Dollar, and his most recent book, Against Empire, which exposes the brutal realities that are a byproduct of U.S. global domination. One of his most noted books, Democracy for the Few, is in its sixth printing and has sold over 250,000 copies.
Sixth edition.
Well, Dr. Parenti, thanks for joining us this evening on Network X.
Nice to be here.
One thing we were talking about before the show is supposedly one of the biggest reasons that the United States had this massive, massive military infrastructure was that there was this red menace out there that we needed to protect our strategic interests from. You know, we went through the Red Scare of the 50s, and now supposedly all of that's gone. As they like to tell us, quote unquote, communism is dead, and the evil empire no longer exists. Yet this recent Congress has bestowed more money on the Pentagon than it's even requested.
Well, the Soviet Union really was a threat to a U.S. corporate class. From the day that Soviet Russia came into existence, the United States, with 14 other countries, invaded Soviet Russia with troops in four different fronts and stayed for about 3 years, killed an awful lot of people, and tried to undo the Russian Revolution. And when that failed, there was another 60 or 70 years of Cold War animosity, invasion, Nazi invasion, in which the Western powers sort of sig Hitler onto Russia. So they did see Soviet Russia and the larger Soviet Union as a threat, in the sense that it represented a different way of using property, money, profits. It was a threat to capitalism. It never really was a threat to our freedoms, because the Soviets weren't particularly out to get the Americans or anybody else, although they did believe in their system and they hoped other people joined it. The problem is that other people did join, at least the problem for the U.S. policy elites, whose goal is to make the world safe for the Fortune 500, whose goal is to make sure that the land, the labor, the markets, the capital, the resources of all these various countries and natural resources are available to the corporate 500, the big multinational corporations, on the best possible terms. And while we were told that we needed a massive global empire to protect us from the Soviet menace, and while the Soviet Union was portrayed as a country run by people who were just driven by hunger for power, 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 power. And in fact, the first 100,000 that marched in the streets, they gave up all that power. It was really kind of strange, you know, that these power-hungry fellows just let the whole country dissolve like that. It'd be nice if that could happen in Guatemala or in Zaire or Turkey or any number, or Indonesia, any number of the other right-wing fascist countries that the U.S. supports today. Yeah. So the question then did come up, as you posed it, why now do we still have this global empire with hundreds of major military bases all around the world, spending $243 billion, this most recent budget? And the answer is that the goal is not just to undo the Soviet Union. The goal is to make sure that the entire world stays within that global corporate capitalist system. And that's what GATT is all about. That's what NAFTA are all about. That is to undermine the sovereignty of these various nations and keep them safe for the Fortune 500. And that means being able to send troops wherever you need to send them to stabilize the situation and to roll back any kind of reformist government. It's not just a communist government now. The U.S. sends troops in to intervene in any kind of revolutionary situation. Nicaragua, which had a strong Christian overtone to it, but the Nicaraguans, the Sandinistas' sin was that they were taking land from the rich and giving it to the poor. Well, you can't do that. The people who run this country do not want anything taken from the rich and given to the poor. The whole goal is to siphon up from the working masses wealth and accumulate it in the hands of fewer and fewer, greater and greater accumulations. And so for that, you have to send troops in. The American people, it's nothing in terms of their interests. It doesn't really help them in any way. But you wave a flag in their face and you say that we got to go in to take Panama because we got to get rid of this drug dealer Noriega. I mean, when you think about it, the absurdity, the pretexts that are given for U.S. interventionism, Noriega, to invade a whole country, bomb El Sharia, the working class neighborhoods, which were his strongholds, kill 3,000 Panamanians, estimates from 3,000 to 6,000 killed, go in there, occupy it with troops, spend hundreds of million dollars to get one drug dealer. Mm-hmm. I mean, George Bush couldn't find drug dealers right in Miami, bigger ones dealing with larger quantities of drugs, and put them in jail. He never was able to do that, but he had to go in for Noriega. So the goal now is not only communist governments, not only governments that set up alternative ways of using the land and the labor and the resources, but any kind of economic nationalism, any kind of economic reformist government, and any kind of show of independence by any country, even a conservative one like Iraq, with Saddam Hussein, who was CIA. I mean, the guy was a CIA product. Mm-hmm. But what he started doing was going into business for himself and saying, well, look, Iraq needs decent oil price supports, and we don't like what Kuwait's doing. Mm-hmm. We don't like what the oil cartel is doing. There's an economic war against us, and we're going to fight back. And then he got hit very hard for doing that.
So in much the same way, I guess, then that's the threat that Cuba still poses. It essentially is a functioning alternative system about 90 miles from our shore.
Right, and people who say, how foolish our foreign policy is, how stupid going after little Cuba, what is Cuba going to do? I mean, it's an obsession, and people, that's not an obsession, it's perfectly correct and perfectly rational policy. If you're a capitalist and your goal, if you're president, if you're you're part of the Trilateral Commission, which Bill Clinton is, you're part of the Council for Foreign Relations, which Bill Clinton is, you're part of the Bilderberg Conference, which Bill Clinton attended with David Rockefeller. Your goal, I mean, they bring you out of a little Arkansas and put you up here because you got to do certain things for them. And your goal was to get GATT through a Democratic Congress, and your goal is to look out for American capital. And that means to get rid of the danger of the good example, mm-hmm. the danger of an alternative system. And Cuba most certainly is a threat to these guys. You could have a country of 14 million people where all the land is collectivized, mm-hmm. where the industry is publicly owned.
Almost everybody is literate.
Everybody is literate.
The
level of universal health care, everyone has an education, everyone can see a doctor. Mm-hmm. The rich have been kicked out and have to go live in Madrid and Miami and New York or Mexico City. I mean, that sort of thing, you can't allow that. We just don't want that. But you don't say that to the American people. You say, we want freedom, we're worried about, there's no freedom in Cuba. Well, that's not true. That's not really the concern. And that was evidenced in Russia. When Gorbachev in 1991 put through all those democratic reforms, elections, free press, all sorts of diverse political parties, and all that, the U.S. still didn't give any aid, and the U.S. still said, but you have to complete the reforms. Mm-hmm. You have to still, and the, what were the reforms? To go to a free market. The goal really is to make the world safe for the free market.
That brings us to one of...
So-called free market. It's really not free. A free market is free only for people who have money.
Well stated. That's
when you got the... That's when it's free, yeah.
That brings us to one of America's more recent interventions in Haiti.
Mm-hmm.
What was the strategic interest there, or the threat to capital in Haiti?
Well, Haiti was going fine. I mean, Haiti... the U.S. had intervened in Haiti back in 1919, was it? And they stayed for about, I think it was 21 years or so. They killed 18,000 Haitians, and they set up this Duvalier regime, which was a bunch of butchers who went on killing and killing people. And what you finally had was that the Haitian Democratic Forces actually overthrew that government, got an election going, and elected Father Aristide. Mm-hmm.
The Lavalas movement.
Right, and made him president of Haiti. And then again, he was overthrown by these generals. Well, it doesn't look good. We profess to be for democracy here, and it didn't look good. I think really what it was there was a fear that the repression, that it would go the way of the Philippines, or the Dominican Republic, or Nicaragua. That is, you can sometimes get a butcher in there who's so bad, who so alienates everybody, that eventually what he does is mobilize democratic forces, and you'll be faced mm-hmm. with a popular revolution. So, and also, Haiti was suffering from what you might call surplus repression. I mean, the killings were just getting out of hand. You know, these. Mm-hmm. These Tonton Macoute descendants would just go into a store and shoot a guy in the head, the owner of the store, and take the money and say, oh, you're a communist or something. You know, I mean, the stuff was getting out of hand. So the goal, I said before Clinton ever sent troops in, I said the goal is going to be to go in, clean up their act, keep the same people in, the military and the police, which is exactly what they're doing. And that's the fight now between Aristide and the American occupiers, which is that we don't want these people as our military. We want to set up our own military. These are the people who've been killing us. And the U.S. is saying, no, no, it's much nicer. We're sending them now to officer school, and we're showing them how to, you know, act a little more smoothly and all that sort of thing. So I really think that what you got in Haiti is a very curious situation where Aristide is riding the tiger. He went in under the guise that, well, maybe he'll be able to get to make some reforms, and but he's had to make these enormous concessions. The concessions were to the IMF, which is he would not raise the minimum wage in Haiti from $2 a day, not an hour, $2 a day to $4 a day. That was his goal. No, that's out. Mm-hmm. He isn't allowed to raise the minimum wage. There are no more import protections. It's now wide open. The U.S. can come in, and they're pouring their goods in there, and whatever little Haitian industries are getting wiped out from it. and taxes on businesses have been pulled back. In other words, a whole bunch of concessions, the usual IMF concessions, which advantage the foreign investors, the big property owners, and are going to be hard on the poor people. By the way, that's not my particular analysis. That was right in the papers. There mm-hmm. were people who were saying, well, this isn't going to be too easy for the Haitian poor. Mm-hmm. And the exchange was, you know, we take over your country even more completely than ever, and in return, we'll give you the shell of governance, and you can go in as president, and we'll clean up the surplus repression. There won't be as many killings as there used to be. And then maybe Aristide is hoping, as he's in, he can leverage in some way and maybe develop Haitian democracy to the point where the government can also take over the state. See, that's the problem you have. And you still have that problem, for instance, in South Africa. Mandela is president. He's got his ministry, and he has the government, but he hasn't gotten hold of the state. Allende had the same problem. He got elected president, but he couldn't get hold of the state. The state are the instruments of the courts, the military, the police, the secret intelligence, the instruments of coercion and control, finally. So you have a hard time there. You have a hard time actually taking state power.
So do you think in the case of South Africa, that's what's forced them to sort of neutralize the whole element of the Freedom Charter, which they rode to power on?
Yeah, I think you mean the ANC?
Yeah. Sort of forced to compromise on
them, you might say? They've had to make any number of compromises. It's the same, and the hope is, well, maybe we'll be able to get a half a liter of milk to the kids, which is not a small thing, you know, if you're worrying about children starving. And the American left is notorious for not worrying about those kind of things. They want to know, are there elections? Are they acting like Stalinists? Are they being Stalinists? Are they using coercive force, you know? Well, sometimes coercion against imperialism isn't a bad thing at all. I mean, the imperialists invented coercion. They're the purveyors of force and violence. But getting some kind of thing, electrification into the townships, getting some kind of literacy programs going, those kinds of things. So far, he hasn't been able to deliver too much. Mandela might have a somewhat easier time of getting a few reforms in because he has a richer country than Aristide can do in Haiti.
Yeah, I know a lot of people were expecting one element of the Freedom Charter to be carried through, and that was nationalization of the vast amount of wealth that South Africa actually has access to. If that occurred, I think we'd have a very different world, not just a very different South Africa.
Well, that'd be out of the question. I don't know who actually anticipated that. I can't imagine anybody thought that there was going to be nationalization. But not until you take state power. State power means your army takes over. Then you can nationalize the things. And even then you would have a very hard time because you still then would have to face international capital, other markets, and the whole squeeze and crush that would come on you, the invasions, the mercenary forces that would come in and start burning your collective farms and your clinics and killing your people. You know, you'd have to be able to police your whole country and protect it against these kind of forces, which is very hard to do, as evidenced in Mozambique and Angola, where millions of people have been killed by these CIA counter-revolutionary mercenary forces. So revolution is a tough, hard thing. Not just taking state power, but being able to hold on to it in the face of this kind of fascist power. The horrible thing is the U.S. public doesn't even know this. I mean, there's no, large numbers of people, it's amazing how many people, though, still oppose U.S. interventionism and still wonder if these interventions really help the poor and are skeptical about U.S. policy. But plenty of them think that, judging from the students I teach, they think that the U.S. intervenes for the most benign reasons. I remember having a student say to me, I cannot believe that George Bush is delivering a war against Iraq for the reasons you said, oil and destroying economic nationalism and keeping global hegemony. I can't believe those are the reasons. He had to believe that it was because there was this wicked guy there and the white knight was fighting the wicked guy. He said, I have faith in the president. And I always say, you have faith in the president? You know, I mean, faith is the last thing you're supposed to have in a president. In a democracy, we have no room for faith. Keep your faith, your trust, your loving trust, and your unquestioning faith and trust, keep that for your family, your close friends, your loved ones, and even them, check them out once in a while, you know, you never know. But for democracy, the essence of democracy is not trust, it's distrust. The essence of democracy is accountability, exposure, debate, challenge, and distrust, and questioning. And democracy is an invention by the people of history to protect themselves against the powers of wealth. I mean, that's what it was in Athens in the 5th century, and that's what it's always been. It's an invention by the people of history to protect themselves from the powers of wealth, from the feudal lords, from the great slave owners, from the great latifundio owners, from the big rich powerful interests, the big powerful church that owned half the country, whatever country it might be. And when the people got together and they fought back, those revolutions, that class struggle is the struggle for class equality, and that class equality is by definition also the struggle for democracy.
Mm. Much to my surprise, actually, though, there are numerous people who, in the case of the last U.S. intervention, our most recent one in Bosnia, there are numerous people who are having these doubts.
Having doubts
that
what?
The United States should even be there, that they are going to accomplish anything good for the people that are there, or even for our own interests.
Well, I don't know of any U.S. interventionism that has accomplished too much good. Now, maybe in Haiti, where you know, as I just said, they reined in. There's been a little bit, but not intentionally. That's not the goal. The goal is to advance the IMF program on Haiti, to circumscribe Aristide, to make it a government that's legitimate looking and stabilized, so that business can go on and do what it wants. I mean, ultimately, they don't care who's ruling. What they care about is, do they write the ticket? Do they control the menu, and do they have the whole thing? But I haven't seen U.S. interventionism really. Look at U.S. interventionism into Somalia. I mean, what did it accomplish? It accomplished about 10,000 Somalis getting killed. The Somalians were popping each other off, you know, four or five a day. But after the Americans came in, the kill ratio went up by a factor of 100. Bosnia, I don't see what U.S. intervention is going to accomplish. I know it's going to... Clinton thinks it's going to accomplish something for himself. It'll you know, raise his popularity. He'll look like an international do-gooder. He knows that in every U.S. military intervention, just about every U.S. military intervention I know, public opinion is against the commitment of U.S. troops. After the troops are committed, public opinion swings around and rallies behind the troops or the president, and rallies around the flag and says, well, we got to see this through. Oh, our troops are there. It used to be our boys are there. You can't say now our boys and girls are there. You say our troops are there, and we've got to support them.
Do you think that's the only reason we're there now, or do you think there's something else going on?
He has a number of agendas, and one of them is his own reelection, his need to look like a world statesman, a world leader, and all that. I mean, he's got to go running into Bosnia to solve problems. He can't build homes for the homeless on the streets right here in Seattle or San Francisco or Chicago or New Haven, Connecticut, or name 100 cities in this country where there are thousands of people. He can't solve the problem of homeless Americans. He's got to go run off to Bosnia and act like a big hero and savior there. I think there are other goals. And another goal is, every time you do military intervention, you are legitimating the use of this global empire. You have to explain to the people, why did you spend $243 billion on a military empire last year? And then you can say, well, you see, we have all these, quote, trouble spots,
right,
local
conflicts.
Right,
the theory of the global hotspots.
Right, and we have to be there. There are other adversaries who are potentially dangerous to us, who apparently we had overlooked all those other years when we were concentrating on the Russians. We didn't know these other fellows existed. But the day after the Soviet Union fell, they were talking about, but there were other bad guys around. Well, we hadn't mentioned them before, but we'll find them now. So there's that. You legitimate the whole military-industrial complex and global empire. Mm-hmm. Another reason is the larger reason, which is the whole colonization of Eastern Europe and the breakup of Yugoslavia, the breakup of the Soviet Union, which is to convert these countries into, in a sense, economic colonies. I mean, Yugoslavia was producing a pretty good car, and Yugoslavia had a fairly good industrial base. All that is gone now. It's been broken up. You break it up into small right-wing republics, which are going to be, in some cases, controlled by pretty reactionary conservative people. Put them under the Susan tree of the Germans or the French or the English or whatever. And they have cheap labor, and like Slovakia would be another case. The same kind of thing is happening there. Poland is happening, and much of Russia, too. The deindustrialization of these countries and the reindustrialization through foreign investors taking over the land or picking up the factories at bargain prices and running them on their own terms. Let me add one thing. Yeah. The trouble that happened with breaking up Yugoslavia into these small countries, that task was accomplished. These people were supposedly Yugoslavia broke up because of ancient ethnic enmities. Well, the interesting thing is that for 45 years, there weren't these enmities. For 45 years, these people lived in peace. They lived right next door to each other. There was a high rate of intermarriage and such. But when you destroy the whole social organization, the political structure, you destroy everything else, then people do fall back on their ethnic identities, and then it becomes my tribe against yours for survival. And that's what's happened. And the other reason he may have gone in is the reason he says, which is the thing has gotten so messy that maybe it's time to go in and clean it up and calm it down and stabilize it so they can get on with doing what they really want to do, which is what they really want to do, which is to make you work harder and harder for less and less so that I can have more and more. Mm-hmm. That's the goal. That's really why I do all these things.
And actually tonight,
if I were the guys running the country.
Tonight you're going to be talking about that. You're speaking at the University of Washington tonight at Kane Hall.
Right.
I think around 7:30. And the topic,
University of Washington, Kane Hall, right, yeah.
And the topic of your talk is going to be fascism, the false revolution.
Yeah, it's really going to be about fascism, about Italian and German fascism and what it meant and whose interests were served and why it came about and why it is replicated today in so many places and how it resembles developments even right in our own country, that you can have fascism without the swastika, you can have fascism in a pinstripe suit. In fact, that might have been a good title for the talk, Fascism in a Pinstripe Suit.
You know, as is often the case when we get someone of your caliber in our show, it needs to be an hour rather than a half hour. And we've reached that witching hour to where we've just about run out of time.
Half an hour, we're over. Okay, it's been a pleasure.
Yeah, I want to thank you for joining us this evening on Network X.
Right, thank you.
And we thank you for joining us this evening on Network X and urge you to get over to the University of Washington tonight, Kane Hall, and hear Dr. Parenti's talk. Also, tune into us next Friday at 6 o'clock when we'll be having a show about the Million Man March. So, I'm going to put it to an end here this evening and send you out there with your usual marching orders. Stay informed and get involved. For Network X, I'm your host, Bill Brignoli. Have a good night.
America is essentially a dream.